of certain water infrastructure improvements. Mr. Baxter.
Thank you, Mayor, Mr. Cap, and Council. The development agreement was brought forth for the subdivision of Continental Mountain Estates, thank you. Almost threw up the wrong one. And in short, they're requesting for relief from having to engage the existing fire hydrants that have been in place in the subdivision for a period of time while they go ahead and construct three single-family dwellings. Here with us tonight is Chief Kratz. I brought him here so that he can answer any questions you have from Rural Metro's perspective. I am here to answer any question you have regarding the town code. And we also have Lou Speltz here, the developer, who would like to present to you.
Questions of staff, Council? Councilman Monica.
Thank you, Mayor. Let me just see if I understand the timeline suggested here in this agreement. First thing is that Town of Cave Creek waives the subdivision ordinance 4.6B3 of Chapter 4. Right? That's the first thing that happens. Second thing is the town issues building permits for three lots. How am I doing so far?
I understand it.
Then, as soon as possible, the town will replace the 6-inch line with an 8-inch line. I didn't understand the 12-month notice, but anyway. Then, the owner replaces the 6-inch line with the 8-inch line and installs a 1,000-gallon per minute pump. Have I got that timeline? Who does what when?
I believe so.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman Darby, yes, question.
Thank you. Let's see. So, I guess Chief Kratz would be the gentleman to answer this. If and when the line from the tank to the subject houses is put in and the pump is put in place, do we know that an 8-inch line is going to provide the necessary water flow, not just to those three homes, but to the subdivision as a whole and any home in the subdivision that might need to use the hydrants to fight a fire? In other words, has the analysis been done that says 8-inch line over that half, though, approaching 3/4 of a mile eventually is going to be adequate?
Our utility manager has already reviewed that and taken a look at the modeling on that, and that's what we came up with, the 8-inch line.
So the answer is yes, there has been an analysis, and the utility manager satisfied himself that the flow to the hydrants with that pump installed will be adequate?
Yes.
Thank you. And then one other question, just to make sure I understand what's being proposed. The owner of the property will handle increasing the line size from panorama circle to the subject property. This deal has the town paying for upsizing the line from the tank to panorama circle. That's a question. Is that true?
Correct. That's my understanding.
That's correct. Now, how does that piece of capital improvement fit in with our existing approved capital improvement plan for the water system? Is it if and when that's part of the capital improvement plan, is it presently scheduled to happen, and how much will it cost, and when is that? And I guess when the answer to when it happens will tell me when that money is to be spent on the present plan.
If you're looking at cost, Councilman Durkin in there, present cost is roughly $96,000 ballpark estimated. So time value of money would go up, I assume, mm-hmm. over time. My understanding, it's got in the CIP, it's not in the current CIP. If it's a project, it would be in the future. So that's why he's agreeing to look in 10 years. So it's not, nothing we're going to complete in the next 5 years per se. Does that make sense?
In the present plan, it's nothing we're going to complete in the next 5 years.
Yeah, we do not see it as a, it's not one of the higher priorities for line improvements or line extensions.
And with this existing agreement, should it come to fruition?
Within 10 years. It's given a 10-year timeline. It's really up to the, how the CIP gets developed over the next few years, whether that would speed it up or fall back.
Okay, so we're in the wildest dreams of the property owner, there'd be 20 homes in there and no fire hydrant power.
Within the first 10 years, could be.
Okay, thank you. Two more questions.
Councilman Smith, your questions?
In section 5, I don't see anywhere where it says 10 years. It says town shall construct a new water line as soon as practical.
My impression with my last discussion was we were looking at a 10-year timeline.
Okay.
It
doesn't say that in here, though.
No, it doesn't say that.
Then that change is I'm aware of in this particular agreement. The last discussion I had with the owner was looking at a time frame as far as 10 years out.
Okay. It's pretty obvious that the money isn't there for this fiscal year. Will that be an input into the plan for next fiscal year, or do you have any ideas on when in 10 years it will come in?
I do not know when in 10 years. My understanding is the utilities manager, what the utilities manager would have it on the CIP. It's an item that's on the CIP.
Thank you.
Councilman Durkin, question.
Thank you. If the water improvement is not, if this improvement to the infrastructure doesn't happen and the property owner wants to build homes, isn't able to have the requirement for water supply to fight a fire put in place, how big a tank would he have to put in his development and an associated pump to satisfy the town code in terms of available water for fighting a fire to one residence?
Well, fire flows is left up to any reputable calculation method as approved by the fire official, which is me. A couple of them I have here. It depends on the number of the size of the homes in there. In previous discussions I've had with Mr. Speltz, he was looking at homes in the 6,000 to 7,000 foot range.
Yes?
5,000 to 6,000 square foot range. Chief Kraft was kind enough to run some quick numbers on that. And basically a 5,000 square foot home would need roughly, if it's assumed 25% of it's exposed and the part of that about 2,082 gallons per minute for at least 2 hours.
You guys can't get any better with your hoses.
That's a lot of water, okay. Mayor, members of the council, that's a quick field calculation, and you can run the math pretty finite on a given property if you have the exact dimensions and size of it. We also have IBC and IFC calculations that speak to that also, which still require a fairly high load of GPM to the structure.
Did you say 2,000 gallons a minute? For 2 hours? Mm-hmm. Is that 600,000 gallons of water? How big is the tank? And that's down the
2 million.
2 million gallons? Okay.
Councilman, we can flow easily on a commercial property God forbid it ever happens in this town, but we could blow a dozen appliances at 750 to 1,000 gallons all at the same time.
I can get the picture. Well, I think I get the picture. I probably won't quite appreciate it. Thank you. I don't have another question.
So speaking of the picture, Chief Pratt's council's responsibility to the community is health and welfare and safety. With this proposal, or that the proposal before council, are we putting safety, fire safety in quotation marks there?
Well, Mayor, members of the council, I spoke with Mr. Speltz right before the meeting and explained my position to him that when given the opportunity to have working fire hydrants placed in service before the sticks go in the air, that we always support that endeavor. Any extra structures in the community of that size are going to put a strain on what we do and how we operate. I don't know if that answered your question.
Well, I'm just going to re-ask it. Are we putting quotation marks over safety in regards to fire?
I think so.
So, So, by the letter of the town code, is there something unique about the water infrastructure and this property? Is there a different requirement that Mr. Speltz has to meet in terms of available water flow to his property to have homes being built there than would exist elsewhere in the town of Cave Creek? Is that a coherent question, Mr. Baxley?
I will take a stab at that for you. What it comes down to is our subdivision ordinance, in which he applied under to create this development, requires the establishment of fire hydrants within the subdivision. Once that occurs, then that's when we start developing how many fire hydrants have to be there and the gallon permits have to be provided through those fire hydrants. Because if you're talking about a meets and bounds lot, the town has been undertaking a fire master plan to see where we can install those fire hydrants, because it has grown way beyond where we've ever had fire hydrants in the past. And we're looking to install those. However, if somebody was to come in and bought a lot out of Spur Cross or something like that, we would not deny them that. One of the things that we do have in the town that helps a little bit is that we do have a fire sprinkler ordinance. I'm sure everybody thought about that. Residential fire sprinklers are not designed to put out fire. Commercial fire sprinklers are designed to squelch fire. Residential are designed to get you out of the home. They're just designed to keep the fire at bay long enough for you to get out of there and make sure that your family's out of the home. So that being said, as a developer, the subdivision ordinance kicked in that requirement for him to have fire hydrants in there.
Thank you. Additional questions, Mr. Councilman Bucks?
Yeah, Mr. Speltz were to be nimble enough at this point in time to put in his pump in an 8-inch line from Panorama Circle or whatever the name of it is, and we're feeding that with a 6-inch line, would that be adequate?
That wouldn't be prudent for me to respond to one way or the other, because that would be something that Mr. Prinzhorn would be able to actually calculate and be able to give you that answer to.
There needs to be a 1,000 gallon per minute pump in that process.
Yeah. If he had that pump in that 8-inch line, could he suck 1,000 gallons a minute and push it up an eight inch pipe from a 6-inch pipe that's coming from somewhere else? I understand the ordinances he's working under. If he was nimble enough, he'd have that equipment in, and if we were nimble enough, we'd have all the fire hydrants in town that we're talking about. I'm wondering if we're, I don't know, it just seems grossly unfair to me to not let him develop.
Council on questions. Council, any other questions? If not. Okay, the applicant, Mr. Self.
Hello, Mayor and the Council. To answer your question, you can't put a, we can't suck from a 6-inch pipe. It has to be 8-inch all the way. Basically, this request is a matter of, in my humble opinion, of fairness. I've already spent $450,000 on off-site improvements, improving 72nd Street, resloping 72nd, paving 72nd, and putting in new water lines, new pump to run the fire sprinklers for the homes, and pavement on Continental Mountain Estates Drive, not coming into the subdivision, and replacing that water line, 4-inch line with an 8-inch line. And I think the state law is pretty clear that exactions by cities and towns have to be proportionate to the subdivision development. And they do make exceptions for topography and a lot of things. So the problem is that this is a subject in the subdivision ordinance. And that's where this thing comes from, because the town doesn't have very many fire hydrants, to my knowledge, so fire is an issue all over the town. So this is the 12th year since this process started. We haven't got any homes built up there. And I, for sure, when we originally requested this subdivision, in 2001, November 2001, I have no idea what the condition of the water system was. It was totally misrepresented to me. The town didn't own it at the time, and I think the town didn't know what the condition was. And the line coming up from the water tank to Panoramic Circle is 52 years old. It needs to be replaced anyway. I don't know how much, you know, that thing is on borrowed time right now. So, I don't know, this is really all about fairness. I'd like to get something built before the next recession, which will probably happen in about 18 months, 2 years. And this would allow me to at least generate maybe a sale or two to get the cash flow, because my cost of my proportion of this is $350,000 to $375,000. It's a lot of money, and we're only talking 13 lots here. This is not a big subdivision. The town will benefit eventually to the tune of probably a little over $300,000 in fees if all the homes are built. I can't think of anything else. You guys have any questions?
Questions from council? Councilman Bunch.
Mr. Spells, you know, you could have originally just split that into three lots, and then I would have had all these headaches, but you went with the subdivision. Why in the world would you, did you not know what was involved? Or?
Where is he in there? He's the one that talked
to
him.
Yes,
I wish I had. Looking back, I wish I had done that.
Yeah.
Some questions.
Question for town manager. Are there other lines in town that are that would normally be ahead of this line to be for replacement that can be swapped in places?
You can move things around in the CIP. You can move, yes. You can move things around in the CIP. We have other lines in the same condition here, where they have, they go from an 8-inch to a 6-inch to a 12-inch, for example. So I don't design or work on the system. Some of the things that exist in deep creek.
Councilman Bonacito, question. Councilman Watts, question.
Town manager, based on what you just said, we can move stuff around. I suppose as long as we're not building, there's nobody's building houses up there, it's not really a high priority then, is it?
I think that's your judgment call, more than I.
Yeah, just trying to point obvious stuff out.
Not to be flip up, we do rotate items on that, on a capital improvement plan over time. Things take higher priorities for all the things, just depending on the environment that we're dealing with.
Councilman Durbin, question. With the existing lines in place, is there enough water pressure, water flow to support a residential sprinkler system for a 6,000 square foot house? In other words, is the safety of the sprinkler system doing its job to let people exit the building, you know, while it burns down, compromised with the existing line? I think I'm asking Chief Kratz.
Councilman Durkin, I haven't seen any of the calculations on this, so I really am going to have to defer to either one of these gentlemen.
And the calculations apparently were done by Mr. Prince, who's also, like, he's conveniently absent. Okay.
Very sufficient.
Remember, the requirement for automatic sprinkler system in the house is much less than required fire flow for actually fighting fire. Again, having said that, I haven't seen the calculations on what that line feeds up there, what kind of GPM to each individual lot.
Let me ask a different question. This would be directed to Mr. Baxley. Considering the issue of fairness or equity or something like that, how many homes in Cape Creek have sprinkler systems installed?
Every home since 2004.
How many is a number?
That would be, you're asking.
Or a percentage.
Yes.
Percentage.
Since growth in 2004, I'm going to guess somewhere in the neighborhood of, including the multifamily stuff, probably 30% of the residences.
30%.
That's a wild guess.
No, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Question. Anything else? Thank you. Okay, there's public comment on agenda item number 6. No comment? Number 5 tonight. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, number 5. Mr. Servo.
Terry Zirkle, Cape Creek resident. And just briefly, back when this subdivision was approved in 2006, prior to its actual approval, the council, mayor, and staff met with residents of this neighborhood and represented that all the infrastructure off-site and on-site necessary to service this subdivision was going to be installed by the developer. What happened that this water line, if it's now has to be an 8-inch line, wasn't caught back then? When did this happen? When did this change occur? It's actually very material, I would suggest. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith.
David Smith.
David Smith, Cave Creek citizen. I would suggest that there are more than enough issues with this proposal to vote it down. First off, a waiver of section 4.6B3 of chapter 4 of the subdivision ordinance would say, what 3 says is each lot or parcel should be supplied with potable water sufficient volume and pressure for domestic use and fire protection purposes. You're waiving that if you sign this. No domestic requirement, no fire protection requirement. The 8-inch line, 8-inch line provides a little less than twice as much water as a 6-inch line. The standard for Cave Creek, 4 gallons per minute for fire protection, has been 2,000 gallons, as the chief stated as what would be appropriate. Some other municipalities have a lower number, but Cave Creek's has been 2,000 gallons per minute. This is not in the CIP. This was never even considered for 20 years. What the town would be buying if this is signed off, in addition to waiving some potentially dangerous things with a lot of liability, is installing a line that goes from the Rockaway Hills water tank up to the circle, with no requirement that there be a line going from there to Continental Estates. It says it will happen, but there's no bond behind it, there's no financial support behind it, and if, say, Mr. Stelz's operation went under, the town would have an 8-inch line to the circle with no potential use beyond that. It also would be spending $96,000 when there's no guarantee that there would be any other use for it. As I said, I think there are just so many issues here that, it also goes out 10 years. You know, if there's other development in that area, an 8-inch line is going to be insufficient. 8-inch line is probably insufficient anyways. 1,000 gallon per minute pump. Well, that, you know, what if it's two houses that are on fire or something like that? You're certainly not going to be able to handle what would be required in order to provide protection to the citizens of the town of Apt to live there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith.
Janelle Smith Hack.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. A lot of the issues have been addressed already, but the first issue I wish to address is whether the council even has the authority to grant this waiver, as section 4.6 of the town's subdivision ordinance makes the developer's compliance mandatory, not discretionary. Other issues include whether this council has authority to give the applicant a period of 10 years to perform under this development agreement. Which provision in the town's subdivision ordinance gives any developer 10 years to perform? Amendments such as this fall under the same guidelines as original applications, and that performance timeline is 3 years. Section C states that the purpose of the agreement is to facilitate the proper municipal zoning designation and development of the property by providing for, among other things, conditions, terms, restrictions, requirements related to infrastructure improvements. The proper zoning designation is already in place, and our town's subdivision ordinance provides for the conditions, terms, restrictions, and requirements related to infrastructure improvements. So why does the town even need to enter into a development agreement with this applicant? In section D of the agreement, it says that the town is to financially benefit through tax revenue. The only tax revenue benefit would be through property tax, sales tax, or development fees. We don't pay property taxes, so the town won't reap any financial benefit through this revenue source. The likelihood of any financial benefit from sales tax is small to non-existent, because we can't require that purchases related to the building of the homes in the subdivision be purchased only in Cave Creek. The only other source of revenue is from development fees, and the developer is asking council to defer or waive that source of revenue. So what exactly is the financial benefit to the town under this development agreement? While giving the developer a timeline of 10 years to perform, number five of the agreement requires the town to commit to payment and installation of a new water line by a date certain. Where is the cost-benefit analysis for the town's purchase and installation of the water line in comparison to the loss of revenue resulting in the council's waiver or deferral of this revenue fee? When is the waiver to take effect? After three homes are built or upon issuance of three building permits? The motion is based on Mr. Speltz's email to Rural Metro, which states that he will seek a waiver, quote, for an extension of time after three homes are built. However, section 3 of the agreement states that the waiver shall be effective, quote, upon owner's receipt of three building permits. If the waiver is to be effective upon owner's receipt of three building permits, the town has no enforcement ability against the applicant, as section 3 also states in part that owner's failure to satisfy any of the terms and conditions of the ordinance shall not in any way prevent, hinder, or delay the issuance of any permits and approvals relating to the development of the property and construction thereon. To reinforce this immunity provision, number 4 requires the town to, quote, expedite any and all approvals required for owner's development of the property or any portion thereof. This agreement not only closes the applicant with immunity, it is tantamount to giving preferential treatment to Mr. Speltz over other applicants. And lastly, for the record, how many times has the council waived fire protection criteria? What were the circumstances involved with those waivers, and how long were those waivers for? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith.
Kerry Smith, Cave Creek Resident. First, I want to say that my wife and I are beneficiaries of Mr. Speltz's road and improved water. And so we are the folks beyond what the other Mr. Smith referred to that actually benefit from those actions. And so while I'm in favor of fairness because of the investment and so forth that Mr. Speltz has undertaken, this is an indication again of a point that I raised at an earlier meeting, asking for some clarity from the staff on exactly what provisions of these kinds of resolutions mean. I didn't know until the earlier Mr. Smith spoke what the waiver of section 4.6.3 of the town ordinances meant. Now, I suppose I should have taken the time to try and find the ordinances and actually read it. But it would have been easier if the staff had provided a brief two-sentence summary of what that meant. It would be easier to interpret. So that's the first issue. The second is there are, as mentioned earlier by other speakers, some lack of clarity in the timing of obligations for parties involved in this agreement. That would be something else that could actually have been pointed out as helpful to a lay person like myself reading this and trying to understand really what's the issue. 10 years under one term, quickly and as soon as possible under another term. The third issue is precedent. Does the establishment of a waiver for this subdivision have other implications for other, say, random subdivisions like Cahaba Springs? Would doing something here establish a precedent that would influence what the council should be required to do in that case? Now, what I'd like to see is some way of developing a middle ground where a person who has been done a considerable amount to certainly make my life better see a path forward, but not at the expense of being granted the right to build homes that don't have potable water. I wouldn't have known that. The other Mr. Smith hasn't pointed that out, that that's what the waiver meant. And not at the expense of suggesting that an agreement that was going to provide fire protection for the new homes that will be built, and therefore indirectly, frankly, provide greater fire protection for me, be just put aside. So I'd like to see more effort at a middle ground and hope maybe the staff, by working more, could avoid a very negative outcome for Mr. Speltz, make it a bit more favorable, but not at the cost of compromising fire safety, potable water, establishing precedents that we really don't like, and agreeing to timelines that are vague. And so I think there's a middle ground here, but it's got to be clear.
Thank you. Public comment is still open on this item.
Can I make a address what this gal said?
As long as the public is done commenting, you'll have the last word on this one. No more public comment? You have the last word, Mr. Stone.
I'm not asking for a waiver of any fees that she mentioned, but that's not the case. The timeline is a little fuzzy, I agree. But that was done, it was kind of left blank, so the town could plug in whatever they felt the timeline that they could live with. And we're only asking for a delay in doing the water line for 3 building permits. After that, we won't be able to build any additional houses until the water line is installed. So it's not, I don't know if that was clear or not, but that's the intent. Strictly a temporary situation. And I think your attorney would agree, maybe she won't, but the town, the state law specifically allows towns and municipalities, in fact, mandates them to take into consideration things that can be accepted, like topography and water lines and cost and proportionality and all of those things. So when you talk about precedents on subdivisions and everything, if we had known the cost of this from the beginning, I would have asked the council for an exception agreement to that subdivision ordinance, excluding the fire.
We are questions or motion?
Question.
Question.
Question for council. Does council have the authority to waive this subdivision ordinance?
Members of the council, there's no specific provision in the subdivision ordinance for waivers. However, generally the law says since council establishes those requirements, council may alter them, which would be waived. But I'd like to point two things out in that regard, if I might. One, Mr. Speltz referenced the fact that state statute gives towns the authority to modify certain requirements based on specific circumstances. That's true, but I would hope in that case that the development agreement would set out with more specificity those circumstances. And it also goes to the question about the concern raised about precedent. One way to avoid the problem of somebody else saying so-and-so got it, I should too, is to set out in agreement what the specific circumstances are that lead council to waive the requirements in this agreement. And then one last thing I would like to call council's attention, although one of the citizens did read it. Although it says specifically that you're waiving one provision, the next sentence says that their failure to satisfy any of the terms and conditions of the ordinance will not prevent, hinder, or delay their being able to build. So that, to some extent, is a pretty broad possible waiver, if you will. So, going a little bit more than you asked, but I thought this was really important just to point out what you're considering.
Thank you, Councilman. A question?
A motion.
A question, Councilman Martin.
This is a question for Mr. Speltz. If you want to walk back up here again, I appreciate it. my understanding of this is that once you get three permits and the buildings are started and or it, it, is it completed where you'll have the funds in order to do the improvements that you need, or where along that line does the funding come in for your portion of what needs to be done from Panoramic Circle up to?
You have the completion date and then you have the sale date, which may or may not be the same. The three permits should, if it's in this environment right now with the banks and the lending, it's difficult to get a loan to build anything on a spec. These would be a spec house. There should be enough cash flow after three building permits to fund the $350,000 to $375,000 water line.
And the pump.
And the pump, of course. And as far as potable water,
you've got that.
We're not asking for a waiver on that. There's already.
It better be. It's coming from us.
That's right.
Okay, I guess I'm done.
No more questions?
No more questions.
Councilman Durkin, you have a motion.
Thank you. Move to approve resolution R2014-17, a resolution of the mayor and town council of the town of Cave Creek, Arizona, authorizing the mayor to approve a development agreement between and among the town of Cave Creek and LS and SS Properties, Inc., an Arizona corporation, providing for the waiver of certain subdivision requirements and providing for construction of certain water infrastructure improvements.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Councilman Durkin.
Gentlemen, I'm not in favor of encumbering the town or tying the town to any specific dates for spending money in this regard. It's my understanding that any homes built here, while not protected by fire hydrant, as far as fighting fires goes, will still be required to have in-home sprinklers. If an individual, as opposed to someone who owns 20 lots, we're going to undertake to build a home in this area, since it at that point wouldn't be a subdivision, he wouldn't be encumbered with the same restrictions that Mr. Speltz is encumbered with. And notionally, 70% of the homes in Cave Creek don't have sprinkler systems, and I know I'm a long ways away from any fire hydrants, as are many of the homes in Cave Creek. So whereas we have, with good intention, subdivision ordinances that attempt to ensure that the homes in the subdivision will have premier firefighting or fire protection. The fact of the matter is, in Cave Creek, we don't have that for most of the homes. And I think I don't want to force the town to spend money by any certain timeline, but B, I think it's important that there be some semblance of equity and fairness associated with people who want to build homes in Cave Creek as compared to as regards to other people who have built homes in Cave Creek and not been so encumbered. So I would propose to amend the agreement before us, removing any requirements that the town pay for and or install that upgrade from 6 inches to 8 inches, and let the town do that as time and money indicates in our capital improvement plan.
Does the second still stand? The author of the motion is amending this own motion.
Yes.
You still have the floor, Councilman.
No, I'm finished.
Thank you, Councilman Munch. You have a second?
Councilman Durkin put it rather succinctly, I think, and for me, it's, I mean, if 70% of my house doesn't have a sprinkler system, and until I bought a fire hydrant, it was 800 feet or so to the nearest fire hydrant. So I was really taking a chance with that. The fact that other people can build with the same constraints that Mr. Speltz has is a concern to me. Rules, it's good to follow the rules, but when they're not fair and equitable, you need to do something different. And I'm of a mind that in this case, it's not fair and equitable where we have to spend a whole bunch of money to put in an 8-inch line in order to facilitate the 8-inch line and the pump that he needs to put in. And it's a chicken and egg thing. I mean, it's not going to happen if something doesn't start up there to begin with. So I'm going to support it.
Councilman Monacino.
It's property rights.
No, it's not property rights.
I'm sympathetic to Mr. Speltz. He spent an awful lot of time and money and energy in this project. But we in fact do have rules. And a council in 2004 said, from now on, we're going to have sprinklers. I don't remember who was on council at the time, but it is a safety issue. And that's all I'm going to say.
Councilman McGuire.
David Smith stated some facts very well. And I thought his facts were very germane. In suspending regulations that have to do with safety of construction and the residents who go there, I'm very reticent to do so. And in encumbering the town in making expenditures that are not the normal expenditures of the town in order to benefit a particular development also makes me uncomfortable. So I will not support this resolution.
Councilman Spitzer.
I'm a big proponent of fairness also. Unfortunately, Mr. Speltz put himself in this box. And there are, I think in the last 2 years, we spent tens of thousands of dollars replacing water lines where they're leaking, 2-inch lines running across open washes. There's plenty of other places of existing residents that need $100,000 worth of lines replaced. I can't support an exception for a developer who put himself in the position that he put himself in.
Mr. Mayor, yes, kind of a clarification.
Yes, you may.
Gentlemen, the present motion that's on the table requires the town to spend nothing. So your issues with money are moot. And there will still be a requirement that the homes constructed in there have residential sprinklers. So the remarks that there's no fire protection are not valid. I just want to make you aware of what the present motion entails. Thank you.
Councilman March, anything?
No, I think that you seem to have a question, Councilman March.
Councilman Durkin, help me with that. Is this not requiring the town to change the 6-inch line to an 8-inch line?
It is, in fact, not. I modified the proposal. No cost to the town.
Thank you.
Yes. Anything else, Mr. Thank you.
Okay.
I understand the fairness argument. I probably have made a couple before on other issues. You have to be a little careful with them because they're emotionally charged. My concern is more directed toward factual things, safety, setting precedent, That's a little worrisome to me. And after listening to our legal counsel, I think this agreement that is before us is a little bit too broad and needs to be nailed down a little bit better. The roll, please, Carrie.
Councilman Bunch?
Yes.
Councilman Lattekino?
No.
Councilman Durkin?
Yes.
Councilman McGuire?
No.
Councilman Spitzer?
No.
Mayor Francia?
No, by a vote of 4-2, the motion fails. Thank you, Council. We already did 6-7, Council discussion and approval of resolution R-2015-16, establishing all water rates and fees by resolution of the town council. We know that the fees are not changing. Who's presenting from staff or committee?
Yes, Mayor and Council. Well, so 2 weeks ago, we didn't have a heading in the explanation of these fees, and we added that in now. So there should be the installation charges for the water service connections. They put the suspected last time, so we added that in. Again, I repeat, there's no change in any fees that we charge. For us, it's more of a housekeeping motion.
Thank you, Kim. Are there any questions from council on this? Anything from our citizens, public comment on agenda item number 7? Commissioners.
David Smith, Cave Creek citizen. I think that one thing that needs to be emphasized is that in this case, it would not change the way that fees would be modified other than doing a resolution instead of having an ordinance. There would still be a requirement for a 60-day public notice. There would be a notice that would go out saying these are the new proposed fees. Only after 60 days would pass could the council pass a resolution saying those fees are now operative. I just wanted to make sure that gets to public consumption. Thank you.
Anything else from the public? Okay, we're back to council. Thank you, Councilor.
I move to approve resolution R-2014-16, a resolution of the mayor and town council of the town of Cave Creek, Maricopa County, Arizona, adopting the rates and charges for water services to combine Cave Creek and Liberty Health Service area.
So, motion made and seconded. Councilman Spitzer.
I think it's just housekeeping and making it easier on staff to not have to do all the publication that changes ordinances do.
Councilman Durkin, you are the second.
No.
Anything else from council? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes clearly have it. Thank you, Councilman. Agenda item number 8. Dostoevsky, right? Councilman, I have to give you a look. Council discussion and approval to amend the fiscal year 2013-14 budget by transferring appropriations by the following amounts, etc. Robert.
Good evening. Good evening, Mayor and Council. Thank you for the opportunity to present this. I included a little more detail so that the motion would stand self-explanatory and I wouldn't have to speak very long. But I promised a budget cleanup for the prior fiscal year back in July, I think. This is the budget cleanup item for last fiscal year. Okay, so
that's brief.
So basically, there was a little bit of budget overage in the town manager's department in the general fund.
Pre-Peter.
Full disclosure, pre-Peter. And a little bit. And then, actually, compared to the attorney overage, it was a lot less. So there's a little bit of overage in the attorney and then finance. The finance portion was primarily due to bank fees or credit card fees for credit card processing. So we have better proliferation of payers out there utilizing credit cards to help expedite their payments of fees and charges.
And you should know that they would be incorporated at least 3%.
Yes, and yes, of course. In order to, because before, pre-Peter, there was no recovery of this cost, post-Peter, with Peter in charge, we instituted a fee to offset those additional credit card fee costs.
Any questions, or Robert? Councilman Montague.
Thank you, Mayor. Speaking of the budget, we now have the final figures for fiscal 14. True?
Yes, the final figures for actually for the for consumption by our auditors is, have been finalized today and signed. So,
how about consumption by council? And what I'm driving at, can we have a presentation on fiscal 14 at some point?
Yes, the intent for the annual financial is to present it with in conjunction in the presentation of the annual financial report and bringing that to council for approval of the complete document. That's usually how the close of the fiscal year is done, but I can also do a report on the fiscal year in and of itself, just a small report. That'd be fine.
If we wait for the CAFR, we're looking at what, February, March?
Possibly.
No. May I suggest, town manager, a brief presentation, not super detailed, but how did we wind up fiscal 14?
Looking, do you want to do it in the first meeting in December, or do you want to?
That's fine.
That be good?
Fine, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor.
Any other questions of council? There is public comment.
Scared them away.
Hearing and seeing none, I'll bring this back to council. I'll make the motion. Motion to amend the fiscal year 2013-14 budget by transferring appropriations by the following amounts. Council, stay with me on this one. As stated in agenda item number 8 at the council meeting on Monday, November the 3rd, 2014. self-explanatory, that's my 2 cents worth. Councilor, what's your second?
Yeah, that is self-explanatory.
Carrie, this is financial, so call the roll, please.
It's so fast, I don't even get the motion.
Oh, I made it short and sweet.
Councilman Montague?
Yes.
Councilman Durkin?
Yes.
Councilman McGuire?
Yes.
Councilman Spitzer?
Yes.
Councilman Bunch?
Yes.
Mayor Francis?
Yes, by a vote of 6-0, the motion clearly passes. Thank you, Council. Carrie, what time does the chambers open tomorrow for voting?
6 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Don't forget to vote on everyone. Thank you, Council. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Mayor, I was going to read the whole thing.
I know you are.
Yeah, but
before
you get out.
As much as I like to hear your voice.
Councilman Bunch.